Yes, so can we start, sir, with your permission?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yes, sir. So I'll be presenting case of a 15-year-old girl hailing from Bangalore, religion being Hindu, the informant being mother as well as aunt, both being reliable, who was admitted to our hospital on 21st of last month and examined on 21st. Chief complaints being fever from 4 days, pain abdomen from 4 days, and rash from 4 days. History of presenting illness. Patient was apparently normal 30 days back when she started to have loss of appetite and malaise. Now she presented with complaints of fever from 4 days, which was high grade, intermittent type, used to occur once a day, mainly during the night and early morning hours, not relieved on taking medication. Interfebrile period, the patient remained active. Then patient also developed pain abdomen, which was diffuse type, sudden onset, intense colicky type of pain, which used to relieve spontaneously, occurring several times a day, non-radiating type, no aggravating factors, associated with nausea and few episodes of vomiting. Vomiting was non-projectile, non-bilious, containing food particles, and the pain used to disturb her daily activities, including sleep as well as appetite. Patient then noticed rash over the face, mainly on the cheek, nose, and both ears as well. The following day, rash was also noticed over both her upper limbs as well. Rash was red in color, raised, and not associated with any itching. History of loss of appetite with feeling of malaise has been present from 1 month. There's also been history of excessive hair loss from past 1 month. Patient used to attend school online, but from past 15 days, she's not attending her classes and is not showing any interest in her studies. There's no history of myalgia, joint pain, headache, bleeding manifestations, passing black color stools, loose stools, or constipation. There's no history of significant weight loss before admission. There's no history of any small or large joint pain. No history of passing red color urine or reduction in urine output. No history of convulsion, psychotic behavior, or any decline in cognitive function noticed. No history of dryness of mouth, excessive irritability of the eyes, oral ulcers, or genital ulcers. No history of any prolonged drug intake, and no history suggestive of any high-risk behavior. Treatment history. Symptomatic treatment was taken for fever at a local clinic, but there was no relief in symptoms and hence came to our hospital. There was no history of any regular drug intake. Over the course of her stay in the hospital, as she was being evaluated and started on IV medications, there was gradual worsening in her general condition with worsening of appetite, significant weight loss, development of genital ulcers, and intense bilateral external ear tenderness, and recurrent bouts of pain abdomen. Past history of bilateral swelling noticed over the upper part of the neck 15 days back, which lasted for 3 to 4 days and resolved spontaneously. There's no history of any previous hospitalization, no history of tuberculosis or contact with a case of tuberculosis. Menstrual history, menarche was achieved at 13 years of age, initially had irregular cycles for 1 year, but later regularized. Now, for the past 6 months, she has been having irregular cycles again with excessive flow and passage of clots lasting for 5 to 7 days. Previous month, she had 2 episodes of menses in the same month with an interval of 15 days in between and hence started on HRT and was asked to continue for 21 days. Antenatal history, no significant antenatal, natal, or postnatal history. She was developmentally appropriate for age and had adequate scholastic performance. Immunization up to date as per national immunization schedule, but no optional vaccines were taken. Dietary history, so there's no deficit in calorie or protein noticed. Total calorie intake was 2,750 calories per day and protein was 73 grams per day. Extended type of family, third degree consanguineous married couple, 6 members in the family, and sibling is a 10-year-old boy child, healthy, no history of tuberculosis contact, and there's history of obesity in the maternal side is present. This is the pedigree chart. Socioeconomic status, they belong to class 2 modified Kupuswamy scale. And summary of the case, This is of a 15-year-old adolescent girl child who with complaints of history of gradual progressive loss of appetite and malaise from 1 month, bilateral upper cheek swelling 15 days back, which resolved spontaneously, presently came with complaints of fever from 4 days, pain abdomen from 4 days, intense colicky type of pain abdomen, rash noticed over sun exposed areas like cheek, nose, ears and bilateral forearms from 3 days. Over the further course of stay at hospital, had gradual worsening of general condition with significant weight loss, genital ulcers and developed bilateral ear tenderness. With this, would like to consider that child is suffering from a chronic progressive disease with multi-system involvement, probably autoimmune etiology like systemic lupus erythematosus, infective etiology like extrapulmonary tuberculosis, HIV, or presently she has been co-infected with any of the tropical infections, or lastly would like to think of malignancy like leukemia or lymphoma.
Yeah, Dr. Ashray, can we go back?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so few general comments. Now, I'm sure these case presentations should also help you for exams, no? The way you present in exams. So if I ask you the first question, how long has been the child unwell, according to you?
Sir, according to me, from past 1 month, sir.
Yeah, so for past 30 days. So if your examiner stops you at the chief complaints, fever for 4 days, pain abdomen for 3 days, and rash for 3 days, what will be your differential diagnosis?
Sir, at this present condition, fever, pain abdomen, rash, with the chief complaints, we will take into account infective etiology first, sir. Like any of the infections, like we can have dengue, sir, in the mind. Then we can have typhoid, then we can have malaria, then we can have rickettsial infection. So the tropical infections will come to my mind, sir, first.
Correct. And also possibly if you are highlighting the pain abdomen, somebody can say if there was no rash, acute appendicitis or a urinary tract infection or a renal colic. So what I'm trying to highlight is if you present your chief complaints or presenting complaints only for 4 days, there is no way you can lead to the diagnosis which you are actually looking at.
Yes.
Right? Also, when the story has started for 30 days, I don't think that should be put in past history. Something that has happened a year back or 2 years back, which may or may not be relevant to the present history, can be placed in the past history, but not that something that has happened for the past 30 days.
Yes, sir.
So if I had to give chief complaints, possibly I would say loss of appetite and malaise for the past 1 month, fever and pain abdomen for past 4 days. Maybe that is my chief complaint. Now, if you give these chief complaints, the way you look at this child will be very different. Because now you know that the child is unwell for a month. And so malaria, dengue, typhoid, most of these differentials will be out.
Yes, sir.
You're getting my point. Yes, and sir. What happens in exam is you have examined the child. You have taken a detailed history. And you have already made a differential diagnosis. So what would be running your mind is possibly SLE, leukemia, and those kind of illnesses because it is a prolonged history.
Yes.
The moment you give these kind of chief complaints and if your examiner is in hurry and wants to hear differential diagnosis, you may not even be mentally prepared to answer for a 4-day history. You're getting my point.
Yes.
And also you brought in the neck swelling in the past history. I wouldn't say it is past history because your illness is for a month, right? So neck swelling, whatever it was, it is not past history, it is a part of the present problem. So that should not be put in the past history. So your presentation is good. It gives you a clear story, clear picture. But I think the way you present should define what you want to lead your examiner to, because eventually you have made up your mind for certain differential diagnosis. True. So the very first thing I would say is better say the child is unwell for a month and give your chief complaints accordingly. Otherwise, the way you put your differential diagnosis will be very, very different. Right?
Yes, sir.
Now, if we go to your neck swelling history, do you want to elaborate it further? What was the neck swelling?
Sir, they don't give clear-cut history about the neck swelling, sir. They just told that it was below the ears. It was present bilaterally. It was not painful. And it resolved on its own is what the parents told, sir.
So what could be the possibilities for the neck swelling?
Sir, over here, we can think of one is lymph node swelling, other one is parotitis we can think of, sir. So these were the two possibilities.
Yeah. So, and if you think of lymph node swelling, you haven't, I don't know whether this patient has received antibiotics. So we are not sure why should the lymph node swelling come and disappear. Also, you said it was painless. That we will keep painless in mind. Because that has a lot of bearing on the differential diagnosis that you give in a child with lymphadenopathy, right? Yes, now you also described the rash with great details. So do you have any picture to share of this patient?
Yes, I have, sir.
You will share it, no problem.
Yes, sir. We'll eventually share it.
Yeah, we will discuss it then and there. So the first few comments I would like to make is that better present it as a story for 1 month and give your complaints accordingly. It is better to have two or three chief complaints and not more than that as you had. Your description of each complaint is very good. And whenever you take one history, like you have started with fever, better complete it rather than going as if you're translating the patient. So don't do that. Just if you have started with fever, present it in detail and tell what is the current status. So I should know, is the child febrile today or not? And if he is not febrile, what was those medications? What were those medications that brought in this response? Okay. Yes. Now the next thing is just general comments. You said your diet history. So what was the diet history taken? What methodology did you follow?
It was the pre-morbid diet, sir.
Acha, that was a pre-morbid diet. Yes. I think you should mention that, because you have told me that the child has got significant loss of appetite.
Loss for of appetite, yes, sir.
So, and if you had used 24-hour recall method, then I expect that there has to be some calorie protein deficit.
Yes, sir.
And so your examiner, if he is a little bit trickier, he might question you here saying you said that there is loss of appetite and still the calorie intake is good. So it is better to say that it is a pre-morbid stuff. And I think sometimes 24-hour recall is much easier to put at. I don't know what is the standard way these days, what your examiners expect. But somebody to recall what happened a month earlier, what did she eat a month earlier, is very difficult. Imagine practically if I ask you, what did you eat a month earlier? It's just impossible. Unlike if you ask, what did you eat yesterday? I can kind of list it down. So please check with your professors whether a 24-hour recall method is a better method. And this child is likely to have some calorie protein deficit.
Yes, presently she has, sir.
Yeah, so that is. And there is no objective documentation of weight loss in this patient?
Sir, in the past 1 month, no, sir. From the time she was admitted to our hospital, there was weight loss of more than 5 kg, sir.
Okay. And that is a period of, over a period of?
Over the period of 2 weeks, sir.
Okay, that is quite significant, I would
yes,
say.
Yes, sir.
And So the history that you're presenting now also includes 2 weeks of hospital stay, the course within the hospital.
Yes, sir. So I mentioned it in the treatment history, sir, that's over the course of her stay in the hospital.
Yeah. So now what would be, you also have added hair loss, oral yes, ulcers, and genital ulcers in your history.
Yes, sir.
So can you tell me something about hair loss? How do you say the hair loss is significant?
Sir, like we do plucking method. So one is by that, and other one is more than 100 to 150 hair loss per day, hair particles loss per day is significant, sir. We consider significant.
Correct. So you also, when you are taking a history of hair fall, it is important to mention whether it was diffuse, whether it was patchy, and especially on examination, you will also try to know whether it is scarring or non-scarring. So those are other stuff that you will try to note. Also, you have mentioned about oral and genital ulcers, right? So what could be the causes for oral ulcers in general?
Sir, in general, causes for oral ulcer, one is can be normal nutritional deficiency itself can cause oral ulcer, sir. Other one is, other than that, we can think of any local irritation like her tooth abnormality or any braces if she has put, that can cause local irritation and that can cause oral ulcers. Then we can think of, if associated with such other significant conditions, then we can think of other diseases like autoimmune etiology and those things we can attribute it to, sir.
What autoimmune diseases can cause oral ulcers?
Sir, systemic lupus erythematosus can cause, then we can have Sjögren's, then we can have Behçet's disease that can cause, all these things can cause oral ulcers, sir.
So though it is a non-specific finding in many children, but when you have the symptomatology, the constitution of symptoms, where you have this child who is unwell for a month, adolescent girl who has hair fall, who has oral ulcers, then it becomes very significant, because when you put up the total history together, then the history of oral ulcers does become important, right?
Yes.
And it is also important to note, I think when we examine the child, we will also discuss the type of oral ulcers or where they are present in the mouth also is significant in giving differential diagnosis. Okay. And when you have oral and genital ulcers, if at all it is going on for many months, then you will also think strongly of Behçet's disease.
Yes, sir.
Because this combination of oral and genital ulcer is not very common in other diseases, right? So what we have got possibly is an adolescent girl who is unwell for a month. She has yes. got weight loss and loss of appetite. And recently she's developed fever and she's also developed some rash and pain abdomen. So what do you think is the cause of pain abdomen, like differential diagnosis for pain abdomen in this child?
In this child, this intense colicky type of pain, we can attribute it to mesenteric vasculitis, sir, possibly.
But see, I would try to bring in more common causes first, right? Because if you describe a colicky kind of pain, because the way you described it looks like there is intense colicky pain. So what would then be the common causes? Of
renal stones.
Yeah, can... renal colic, it could be, yes?
Yes, sir. You can think of renal stones, acute appendicitis, acute cholecystitis, all these acute pancreatitis, all these acute causes we can keep in mind, sir.
Yeah. So basically, when you say colicky, you are possibly trying to tell the examiner that I am looking at some obstructive luminal pathology. That's what most commonly causes, say, intestinal colic or renal colic for that matter, or even if there is any obstruction, right? So what I would suggest in this case, I don't know what is the cause of pain abdomen, we will arrive to that, but you should always be careful when you say colicky pain, unless you are really leading your diagnosis to that, because the examiner may want to go back and check with the patient whether it is really colicky or not. And if your eventual diagnosis doesn't lead it there, then be sure with your patient and check whether it is really colicky, because sometimes the patients cannot really describe it properly, right? And yes. Now let's come to your differential diagnosis. Did the child take any medicines recently? Any medicines for?
No, sir. No issue of any drug intake, sir, in recent past, except for the fever for 3 days, which he took in outpatient basis.
The patient has not taken any medicines.
No, sir.
So when you come to an adolescent girl with this kind of constitutional symptoms going on for a month with weight loss and ulcers, and you also have told me that there is a rash. Okay. Now yes. You also described the rash is over cheeks, nose, ears, especially cheeks and nose. So I think if you want to put your diagnosis right at this moment, you can even say it is a butterfly rash.
Yes.
Or a malar rash.
Yes, sir. Malar rash.
Second thing is there photosensitivity?
Yes, sir. So it is present over sun exposed areas, sir, because it is present over the malar area, ears, upper part of the neck and her forearms, sir. So this
is present over exposed area, but when I say photosensitivity, it is like on exposure to sun, is there any burning sensation or is the rash getting worse? So that is what we mean by photosensitivity.
The problem is she was not exposed much to the sunlight, sir. She stayed at home, says okay. She was sick. So that okay. thing we couldn't elicit in her history, sir.
Okay, so that is another thing, because you are really narrowing your diagnosis down, because there are very few diseases practically which will have this kind of malar rash in an adolescent girl who is coming with oral and genital ulcers and a lot of constitutional symptoms, right? So let's go to the differential. So I think yes, because of the total constitutional symptoms, you will have to bring in SLE. But why do you really want to say extra pulmonary tuberculosis and not just tuberculosis? I just was very keen to know this. We haven't examined your child yet.
Cough, there was no thing, like cough was not there, but there was prolonged fever with history of probably lymph node swelling, which she gave 15 days back, sir. So yeah. That is why I thought of extra pulmonary tuberculosis.
Yeah, I'll be a little concerned because I don't know if you have to put it, I'll just put it as tuberculosis and let the discussion be open, because you really don't know, you haven't yet examined your child. And not all patients with pulmonary tuberculosis should have significant pulmonary symptoms. You will see a lot of these patients coming to you with non-specific symptomatology and low-grade fever. And when you examine the patient and you perform imagings, you
see the
involvement of the lungs, right? HIV is fine, but thing is the past history is not at all significant. So HIV
only because of the swelling, parotitis could be, and we took into consideration HIV, sir, and adolescent girl, but there was no any high risk behavior as such, sir.
Yeah, also the past history is not significant.
Yes, sir.
I would still keep leukemia and lymphoma as a DD, although the rash will make it a little difficult. However, a child who is unwell for a month with weight loss and some neck node swelling, I think lymphoma is a good differential diagnosis, right? So yes, you can also bring in certain DDs, especially when you talk of a child with a fever for a month and adenopathy, constitutional symptoms. What other infections can present like this? We always discuss tuberculosis.
Brucellosis can come.
You can bring in brucellosis as a DD, but then you have to take relevant negative history, exposure to...
There was no any pet rearing present, sir.
Okay.
No any unpasteurized milk drinking was also not present, sir.
Sure, we can go ahead then. Yeah.
Coming to the general examination, patient is conscious, cooperative, oriented to time, place and person, but she doesn't seem to be interested in her surroundings, sir. Vitals temperature was 99.1 degree Fahrenheit, pulse rate was 86 beats per minute, regular, normal volume and all peripheral pulses were felt. Respiratory rate was 18 cycles per minute, BP was between 50th to 90th centile, and she was maintaining saturation under room air. Anthropometry, her weight was 55 kg, height was 140 centimeter, which was less than -3 standard deviation. BMI was 28, sir. So by interpretation, obese the child was, and waist to hip ratio was 0.9, sir. Even by that, we can tell that the child was obese. Then head to toe examination, there was no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, or edema. Lymph nodes multipoint significant, like around one to two centimeter bilateral. Lymph nodes were palpable over her neck, sir, mainly in the submandibular region, but other areas also, though it was not significant, it was palpable, sir, which was firm, non-tender and not matted. Head normal, hair distribution was normal, but there was thinning of hair, sir. There was thinning of hair and we could make out that she's been having hair loss, but it was diffuse in nature, sir. Then face, there was erythematous, raised rash present over her cheeks, nose extending to involve bilateral ears and upper part of the neck with scaling, no parotid swelling, eyes were normal. Ears, over the course of stay in hospital, she developed intense bilateral ear tenderness, which was warm to touch. So we thought could be perichondritis. Oral cavity, there was palatal hyperemia present, sir, but we couldn't make out any ulcers. Neck region, no rashes noticed. Skin, erythematous rash present over extensor part of bilateral forearms. Genitalia, at admission, she did not have, but over the course of her stay at the hospital, she developed multiple genital ulcers over the medial aspect of her labia minora. Then no cutaneous markers for tuberculosis were found. SMR staging was stage 4, sir. And this was the image of the patient, sir.
You are continuing, please continue.
Systemic examination, abdomen soft, diffuse tenderness was present, but no organomegaly could be felt. Respiratory system, bilateral normal vesicular breath sounds, no added sounds were present. Cardiovascular system, S1, S2 was heard, no murmurs. CNS, no focal neurological deficit. So provisional diagnosis, 15-year-old adolescent girl, dull looking and sick, not showing any interest in her surroundings, with constitutional symptoms of fever, malaise and loss of appetite, with butterfly-shaped malar rash present over face and other sun-exposed areas, with genital ulcers, with hair loss, which was diffuse, non-scarring, and lymphadenopathy. So probably it is an autoimmune etiology like systemic lupus erythematosus.
We can go back to the examination. So yes. I think when you say that patient is not interested in the surroundings, is your neurological examination normal or is abnormal?
Sir, on doing neurological examination, it was normal, sir, but we had to probe in for everything what we had to do, sir. Even higher mental function, her GCS was fine. Her cognition was also fine, but she did not appear interested in her surroundings. Like even every question we had to ask her 3 to 4 times, only then she would probably answer. And that has been her situation even at home, sir, from past 15 days. And she did not go to a schooling also, sir.
No, so basically here, Ashwa, you have to be very specific because the examiner might really want you to tell what you want to arrive at finally. Because if you say neurological examination is normal, what I mean to say is, okay, meningeal signs are absent. So you are saying there is no meningitis. And you are saying the cranial nerve examination, motor and sensory examination is normal. But the whole question is how have you assessed her higher mental functions? Now it is not only about GCS, the Glasgow Coma Scale, because you will possibly not even apply it in such a child. I think the GCS only stands good when a child is really brought unconscious or semi-conscious, right? Now you have a conscious child, so you will have to tell me about the speech, the language, the memory. It's not a neurology case, but the moment you say that the child is not completely normal neurologically, you will have to tell me this. Now, why is this important? I know that we are discussing SLE, but SLE can definitely have neuropsychiatric manifestation.
Neuropsychiatric manifestation, yes. So we assessed, sir, higher mental function, sir. That only, sir. It was normal, but only on probing 4 to 5 times, she used to give us answer for all the higher mental functions. Sir. So her language was normal, memory was normal, her reasoning and judgment was also normal, sir.
Okay.
That was the status. So we could not clearly tell what it is.
The reasoning, the judgment, and the reaction time. I think these are few things you could objectively assess. So if you say the reasoning, judgment, and even the reaction time is normal, I would have to question your observation that she's not interested in surroundings. Because as such, a 15-year-old girl would be quite anxious if she is in a hospital and if she is running through so much for the last 1 month. So this may be a significant finding, and I would really want you to go back and reassess in such a situation. Why I'm saying this is, this may have implications in the diagnosis as well as in the treatment.
Of the Yes, sir.
Now coming to the rash. So you have described the malar rash, no? So what are the causes for this kind of rash over the face?
Sir, one can be infective etiology, sir. So like parvovirus infection and all can cause slab cheek appearance, rash over her cheeks. Other one can be, other than that, such malar rash is characteristic of SLE, sir.
Right. So one thing is, see, the slab cheek appearance, I think we hardly see in clinical practice, or we are missing it possibly. But the slab cheek appearance, I don't think the rash will go over the
nose, sir.
Bridge of the nose. And yes, the total story also here is not like your parvovirus infection, right? That is fine. Apart from systemic lupus erythematosus, you should always discuss juvenile dermatomyositis. That can also have a photosensitivity rash over the face. And one thing that most examiners would re-discuss is, what is the characteristic of the lupus rash on the face?
It is erythematous, red color, raised lesion with some amount of scaling, which crosses her nasal bridge. Sir.
And there is sparing of the nasolabial folds.
And sparing of nasolabial folds.
Somehow conventionally everyone wants to listen this, so it is better to describe the rash like that. Okay. Yes. Whereas in the dermatomyositis, the rash is usually much more diffuse over the face, and it may or may not spare the nasolabial fold.
Nasolabial fold.
Now, can you tell me some more characteristic rash that will differentiate dermatomyositis from lupus?
Sir, in dermatomyositis, we can have heliotrope rash will be present, sir. That is one thing. Then
heliotrope rash, how can you describe the heliotrope rash? How is it?
Sir, where is it? Periorbital region, sir.
Yeah. So it is basically a purplish hue that you see in the periorbital region. So that is a very characteristic rash, a heliotrope rash. Sometimes there is associated lid edema also, you will see. But the rash is basically in the periorbital region, usually involving the upper eyelids and that region, right? So that is a characteristic rash. What other rashes that you see in patients with dermatomyositis? But
then we can have Gautran's papules. Then we can have that characteristic V-shaped rash, sir. All Shawl these things. Sign. Yes,
you
sir.
Shawl sign. Yeah.
Shawl
is,
sign.
Is there anybody in the group who has joined wants to answer on the rashes on dermatomyositis? I can see a few names there. Dr. Rachna, are you there?
Yes, sir.
So any comments on the rashes in dermatomyositis?
So, like Dr. Ashray mentioned, there is a shawl sign that we see in dermatomyositis, that is the V-shaped rash present over the back. Then there is the violaceous U around the periorbital area with diffuse rash over the cheeks. Also, we see Gautrin's, and there's something known as inverse Gautrin's that can be seen in patients with JDM. Gautrin's is present on the dorsal aspect, whereas the inverse Gautrin's are present over the palm area. So those are some of the rashes that we can see.
Okay, thank you. So you also see something called linear extensor erythema, which is seen on this lateral aspect of those, medial aspects of your forearms. It's called linear extensor erythema. You can see what is known as mechanic's hands, which is more commonly seen in adults, I would say, but we do occasionally see those rough hands. So those are some of the characteristic rashes, right? Now, Dr. Ashray, if you see rashes on the fingers, no? Those over the knuckles and yes, over sir. The PIP joints, those you call the Gautrin's. Do you see any rash on the fingers in lupus?
Lupus.
So if you go back and see, check on the pictures, you will see the lupus rash, when it affects the fingers, it characteristically affects the region between the knuckles and the PIP joint. So over the phalanges, typically sparing the PIP joints. So you will see erythematous rashes over the fingers, sparing the joints, but involving the fingers. Something which is very different from that you see in dermatomyositis. So those are certain characteristic rashes. So, and your oral examination, you said, can you go to the oral examination? So you said that there is palatal hyperemia.
Yes, sir. Over the hard palate, it was seen, sir.
Do you want to make any comments on that?
Sir, it was not characteristically ulcered, sir. It was 2 to 3 linear marks of this thing was present over the hard palate extending up to the soft palate, sir.
That is how important I'm saying is you hardly examine the palate, or you may miss the palate examination. When you're looking at the oral cavity, maybe we are trained to look at high arched palate. That's different. But when you see palatal hyperemia or palatal ulcers, it is a very characteristic sign of SLE. Because there are not many diseases which cause such characteristic ulcers on the palate. And usually we say it is painless in the sense that the patient may not even know that there are ulcers. And that is why looking at the palate is very, very important. Again, I'm saying most often these signs may look very simple, but when you sit in an OPD and you start seeing this patient for the first time, every sign will add value. So if you had seen this patient, say, at a time when this girl had palatal ulcers, a hair loss, a malar rash, you, without doing a single blood test, you will be very sure that this is systemic lupus.
Yes, sir. So
always look at the palate, because the palatal ulcers are very, very characteristic of systemic lupus, right? And in the Behçet's, we often say that those ulcers may be painful, right? If you have seen a patient with Behçet's, the ulcers over the lip, over the tongue, they are quite painful. Unlike in SLE, wherein the patient may not even know that there are ulcers.
She was not aware, sir. Even a genital ulcer, she was not aware of it, sir. Only on examination, we could make out, sir.
So these signs are very important, which you have actively picked up. Okay. Yeah. So let's go on. So we have had this characteristic malar rash. Okay.
Yes.
What is the difference?
And there was sparing of nasolabial fold as well, sir.
Yeah. So there is sparing of nasolabial fold. So what is the difference between, so alopecia in this patient is not, I mean, as you said, there is thinning of hair. Sometimes you have patchy alopecia, but it will be usually scarring or non-scarring in SLE.
Non-scarring, sir. Non-scarring alopecia is characteristic, sir.
So if you see a scarring alopecia in SLE, what kind of rash is that usually? What I mean to say is, what are the other rashes that you see in SLE? You have described a very characteristic rash, but are there any other rashes?
Sir, yes, sir. Acute form and chronic form it can have. So in chronic form, the characteristic of rash will be different, sir.
No problem. Anybody in the group? I can see a few names there. Chaitanya, Soumya, Arshia. Anybody? Any other characteristic rash in chronic lupus which Dr. Ashray wants to describe?
So discoid rash is another rash which we can see in lupus.
Correct.
Which is usually the scarring type.
Okay, very good. So, rightly said by Dr. Ashna. So, basically, discoid rash. So, disc-shaped lesions, commonly you can see over ear lobes or other parts of the body. But it is disc-shaped and it usually heals with scarring. Now, what is the significance of discoid rash, Dr. Ashray? Now, what I'm asking you is, if I have to confirm the diagnosis of lupus, you will do blood test, right? So which is one test you will ask for?
Sir, anti-histone is
No, just one test I'm saying. Usually
ANA, sir.
ANA, anti-nuclear antibody, right? Yes. So yes. In what percentage of patients is ANA positive in lupus?
Sir, around 90 to 95% of the times ANA is positive, sir.
Yeah, so these days we believe almost all patients have it. Right.
Yes,
it is very rare not to have a negative ANA negative lupus. So we'll discuss why ANA can be negative, but that is very rare. So is ANA a good screening test for lupus?
It is a very good screening test for lupus, sir.
But it is not very specific.
Yes, sir.
Why
is
why
not specific for sir?
Why is that? So why is it not specific?
So because even other conditions can be associated with ANA being positive, sir. Other autoimmunity also can be positive, like Jogren syndrome, systemic sclerosis. All those things can have ANA positivity, sir. That is why.
Can healthy children have ANA positivity?
A low yes, titer? Sir. That is also possible, sir.
So roughly we say about 5% of healthy children can have low titer ANA positivity. Okay. Hello. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
I think we lost Dr. Ashray, no? Yeah, Dr. Ashray.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think we lost you in between. Not a problem. So,
yes, sir. Even healthy people can have, sir. Around in 5 to 10% of them can have ANA positivity, but without any symptoms, sir. That is also possible.
So why I'm asking you this question right at this moment was, so I wanted to know the specificity of a finding. That means, so some things have good screening value, some things have high specificity. The discoid rash, which I was talking about, is highly specific for lupus. So if you see a discoid rash, although occurrence is very rare, the chances that you get a discoid rash is very small. But if you pick up a discoid rash, I would say it is 99% specific for lupus. Because you again don't get such findings in other diseases. So that is very important to pick up a discoid rash. Okay. So now, okay, let's move on. Are you going to present any blood tests?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let's move on with the tests then.
So these are the blood investigations, sir. So on the day of admission, when we did, her total count was low, 1,300 it was. Her platelet was also low, sir. It was 1.27 lakhs and peripheral smear showed microcytic hypochromic anemia with leukocytopenia. Sir, with her ESR being raised, sir, her ESR was 60 and CRP was 35. So considering it could probably be still infective etiology, we gave her antibiotic also, sir, along with Pantop and MSAT for a relief of abdomen symptoms. Then even after 48 hours, we did a repeat test. Even then, her total counts were low, platelet was low, and her CRP was still raised, sir. So it did not show any this thing. And her AST-ALT was raised, sir. AST-ALT was 353 and 243, sir. This was significant in routine investigation. Then we ruled out infective etiology, and we ruled out tuberculosis also, sir, because for further treatment also, it was needed. So CBNAT was also negative, chest X-ray was normal. Urine routine also we did, sir. And in urine routine, there was no proteinuria, no RBC CARS or no hematuria. Then HIV 1 and 2 was also negative, sir. So autoimmune etiology, we first did an ANA screening test, sir. So it was strongly positive, this child. So we sent for ANA profile. In ANA profile, anti-ribonucleoprotein, anti-Smith was positive, double-stranded DNA was positive. Anti-AMA-M2 was positive and anti-nuclear antibodies were also positive. And then we sent for APLA antibodies also, sir. So in that, anti-beta-2 glycoprotein turned out to be positive. Serum C3, C4 levels were normal and direct Coombs test was negative, sir. And her USG neck showed multiple enlarged lymph nodes, sir, bilateral. USG abdomen and pelvis were normal. After evaluation also we got done and that was also normal, sir. So this was
we'll come back to the criteria, but let's go to the investigations. So One question, if I may ask, at what day of admission did you do a ANA?
Sir, we did the ANA on 4th or 5th day, sir.
Okay, sure. But you had a child who was unwell for a month, right? And the first CBC showed you leukopenia and thrombocytopenia. So if we analyze the patient then and there on day one of admission, you have an adolescent girl who is unwell for a month and possibly came to you with a butterfly malar rash, hair loss, and if I'm right, oral ulcers, and you have cytopenias.
Yes, sir.
So at this point of time, what would be your differential diagnosis with just with a CBC in your hands?
Sir, SLA only would have been the
diagnosis. Possibly with the cytopenias, I may be worried of a leukemia. If the rash wasn't there, I would be worried because a month's history with some lymphadenopathy and cytopenia will bring in leukemia.
For the same, we got peripheral smears done, sir.
Yeah, no, what I'm trying to tell you is that leukemia and SLE, yes, that's okay. But any infection going on for a month like this, causing this kind of presentation will be very unlikely. Right? Yes. And also for tuberculosis, I don't think you typically see this kind of leukopenia in TB.
Yes.
Unless you are having a disseminated tuberculosis, miliary form, even their cytopenias is not very common finding. And this child was not really that sick looking when you presented in the beginning, right? So yes. What I'm trying to tell you is that this patient possibly warranted an ANA test right at admission.
No, that's number not affordable, sir. That was the...
Sure. See, when we discuss, we should discuss what is ideally to be done. In our kind of settings, there are 100 challenges. And especially from the place where you are presenting, it's a remarkable job that you have thought of the disease and got the diagnosis. And I know that this girl is now doing better. Right?
Yes, sir.
It is a remarkable job. But I'm saying as a pediatrician, tomorrow you people will go out and practice. So possibly... there you will have to decide which test I should order and which test I should not order, right? So I think I'll put my money in this patient on an ANA test rather than other tests, provided the total profile is like this, right?
Yes, sir.
Now, the second thing I want to know is this patient also has high ESRs and very high CRPs, right?
Yes,
and you said the ANA test is positive. So what could be the cause? Now, see, once you have this kind of ANA, I'm sure you're discussing systemic lupus erythematosus, and with a positive profile with multiple antibodies, especially DSDN and Smith, you are talking of SLE. So let us ask, why was there liver involvement? So what I'm asking is, the enzymes were elevated. What could cause such kind of involvement in SLE, liver involvement?
Hepatitis possibly, sir.
Okay. What type of hepatitis?
So systemic lupus erythematosus itself causing, but very rare occurrence, sir. But in this child...
I wouldn't say it's very rare because I don't really remember the percentage now, but I think at least 10 to 20% of these patients do have what we call lupoid hepatitis. So lupoid hepatitis is one where you have this kind of slight elevation of enzyme and it is a part of the illness as there is inflammation going on in the liver itself. What could be other causes of liver derangement in a patient with SLE?
Drug induced.
It could be possibly drugs. Then,
sir, other autoimmune etiology associated with SLE can also come in, sir.
Yeah. So sometimes
primary biliary cirrhosis, all the systemic sclerosis also can be associated. All those things.
So what you are trying to tell is an overlap of two autoimmune etiologies like autoimmune hepatitis with SLE can cause this.
Yes.
Okay. And then it could be sometimes coexisting infections, like you have a background hepatitis B or those kind of infections which are coexisting can cause it. And very rarely we have seen, especially unwell patients having CMV hepatitis along with lupus can present with deranged liver enzymes and cytopenias like this. So you may think about those possibilities. Now coming to your ANA test, tell me the methods by which you can do ANA.
So the immunofluorescence method.
Okay. And?
So that is what I was aware of, sir. Immunofluorescence method.
Immunofluorescence, that's good. So anybody else in the group? Arshia, Soumya, Chaitanya, Dr. Jain or anybody? Rachna, you want to answer?
Yes, sir. So the three methods by which we can perform an ANA test is, one is ELISA, The second is chemiluminescence assay. And the third one, as Dr. Ashri mentioned, is immunofluorescence method.
Okay, thank you. So basically, see, what you mentioned is the best method, or I would say is the ideal method, that is the immunofluorescence. Unfortunately, especially in peripheries, when this method is not easily available, many pediatricians tend to use the ELISA method, which is kind of easily available, but has got lots of false positivity and false negativity. So one should avoid doing an ELISA. Some labs also do chemiluminescence. I think that is also a good method, but then the ideal method is the immunofluorescence
method.
And when you do the immunofluorescence, it is actually done on a HepTu cell line. It is actually a slide where those epithelioma cancer cell lines are there. And then you put your patient sample and do a process and you see the staining pattern, right? And it is a fluorescence pattern that you see. And you have also written the nuclear granular pattern. So that is the pattern that you're seeing under the microscope, correct? So ANA, as we were discussing, is highly, I mean to say, it is a good screening test, but not very specific. And a lot of infections, autoimmune diseases, malignancies can cause a positive ANA. Now, what if I tell you a patient with SLE has got negative ANA, what could be the causes? Now you have a patient, this same patient, I am 100% sure this is SLE, but I tell you ANA is negative. So what could be the causes?
Negative, sir, because only 90 to 95% of them test positive. So it is one of the...
Okay, you feel it is one of those where ANA may be negative.
Sir.
Yeah, that could be a possibility. Although these days, more and more, we believe that almost all patients will be ANA positive. But there are other causes to it. For example, you have used a method like ELISA, which can give you a false negative result, right? So that could be a possibility, your methodology. Second thing is your titers. If the titers of antibodies are very, very high, you can miss it. Why? I'm sure you have read about something called prozone phenomenon. So ideally, the immune complex reaction happens when there is, I would say, that appropriate antigen and antibody. So when the antibodies are very, very high, you will miss it by doing the ANA test. If you do the regular dilutions, like 1:80 or 1:60, 160. And then we ask the lab to do further dilutions, 320, 640, and then they say, yes, the test is positive. So if your suspicion is very high, go back to the lab and tell, do more dilutions on the serum and give us the result. And that can be a possibility, the prozone phenomenon, right?
Okay.
And sometimes, although these days we are using human cell lines, in the olden days, they were using the rabbit liver, kidney cell lines. No, that time also you had lots of, I would say, false negativity, right? So these could be some of the reasons why your ANA test is coming back negative. Right. And occasionally, this is not a very common thing. I have seen patients with underlying immune deficiency. So we have a patient with common variable immune deficiency who have hypogammaglobulinemia and developed autoimmune disease like lupus. Their ANA can be negative. So these could be certain causes for a negative ANA.
Negative ANA.
Right. So once you get an ANA test positive, you do a profile. So what is the difference between a profile and an ANA by IF?
Sir, over here, all the other associated antibodies are also screened for, sir. So this is more specific, sir, for SLE, like anti-double stranded DNA, anti-Smith antibody can be picked up, sir. Because ANA is a good screening test, but it is not specific. Then we come down to doing ANA profile, sir.
So the first thing is you always do an ANA and then do a profile, correct?
Yes,
so you don't really do the profile first, which is very important that all people who are attending or all students should know that always do an ANA. If the ANA is positive, then do a profile. But these are not associated antibodies. So let me explain. You have a nucleus and you have an antinuclear antibody. So this antinuclear antibody is directed towards some antigen in the nucleus, right? That antigen can be dsDNA. That antigen can be Smith. That antigen can be some RNA, histone, which is present inside the nucleus. So once you get ANA positive, you want to know this antibody is directed against which antigen. So that is how you perform a profile. And that profile tells you what is my ANA positive to. It may be because of dsDNA antibody or Smith antibody or multiple of these antibodies. So it is because ANA can be positive in so many situations. Once you do the profile, by looking at the specificity, you can tell what disease it is. Now, which are those antibodies which are very specific to lupus?
Anti-double stranded DNA and anti-Smith, sir.
Yeah, so DSDNA and Smith is highly specific. But how, what percentage of patients are DSDNA positive?
That is only around 30 to 40% are positive, sir. Both the anti-doubles.
Would say different studies would say different, but my understanding, maybe 60 to 70% are DSDNA positive. But that means a lot of patients are DSDNA negative, does not exclude SLE. And anti-Smith is also highly specific, I would say. So what is the other method by which, and now one more thing, when you do the profile, you get multiple antibodies. Like in this patient, multiple antibodies are positive. So yes, whenever you see multiple antibodies are positive, especially with DSDNA, Smith or Rho or La, then you know that this is likely SLE. So the profile will really make your diagnosis very strong, right? Now tell me one thing, what is the other method by which I can do DSDNA? Because whenever you do an antibody, I sometimes may be interested to look at the titers. How much is the antibody titer? Especially
when the immunofluorescence might be.
No, immunofluorescence.
This itself will give the titers.
Immunofluorescence won't give you a titer. No, it just tells me that at this dilution, it is positive. Maybe I can dilute it further and tell you how strongly it is positive. But if I want exact titers in a number, then I will go for ELISA. So if you have seen any ELISA result, it gives you a number. Right. So if you do anti-DSDNA by ELISA, you will get a value like 200, 400, 800. So say if the cutoff is 100 and if the value is 400, I know that this is four times elevated. And that may have some value. So why do you monitor DSDNA titers?
DSDNA will tell us disease response to treatment, sir. That is why DSDNA titers might be helpful.
Okay.
DSDNA is one antibody which will even tell us response to treatment, sir.
So it correlates with disease activity. So even follow up, if I want to see if the patient has got better, I can repeat a DSDNA titer. So my question is, I have a patient who is having lupus like this, ANA is positive, comes after 6 months, a patient is better on treatment. Should I repeat an ANA?
Should we repeat ANA? ANA, she was anyways positive, no sir. So
no, these are the questions patients will ask you. These are the questions we feel are important in practice. So should we repeat an ANA?
Don't think so. There's a role for repeating ANA, sir. Anti-double stranded DNA, yes, sir, we can repeat the titers, but ANA, there might be no role, is what I feel, sir.
So you're right. So if you repeat, the titers might have gone down, but once positive, we say always positive, and there is no point in repeating ANA. So that's very, very important. So unnecessarily, some patients will be undergoing ANAs multiple times because they want to see that the disease is gone. But we know such diseases just don't go away. We have to bring them in remission. So no point in repeating the ANA. So if you want to monitor the disease activity, you can do DSDNA titers. Anything else you can do to monitor disease activity, lab-wise, apart from clinical features? Anything else?
We can see her, in this patient, her hematological values were abnormal. So we can get the repeat CBC done and see whether it is responded to treatment. So improvement in CBC values can be there.
Yes, very good. Then
there was hepatitis part also involved in this patient. So we can look into that as well, sir. So other things, such things can be seen.
Lab-wise. Also had a very high ESR.
Yes, sir. ESR can be repeated. Yes, sir.
So you can monitor the ESR, right? And you can also monitor something more, like the anybody else in the group. What else you can monitor disease activity with? I think there are a few students, but I don't know. They don't answer. Yeah. Okay. So.
C3C.
Yeah. Who said that?
So C3, C4 also we can...
Very good. So you can monitor the complement levels like C3, C4. Because usually if the C3, C4 is low, it is due to consumption of the complement due to an active immune complex mediated disease. So once the patient is better, we expect the C3, C4 to be normal. And if the patient comes back with disease, usually it will dip. But in your patient, C3, C4 was normal even when the patient came. So it is possible that it is normal in some patients. So if it is normal, it doesn't help in an active disease like this. But if it is low, you can always follow them up and see. Now your patient also had a high CRP, right?
Yes,
so
sir.
What does the high CRP tell you?
So CRP tells that there is underlying inflammation, sir, but it is not again specific for anything, sir. That is a problem with CRP.
No, but then in SL, it is not very, in SL, it has got a lot of value, I'll tell you. In your patient, somehow the CRP is strongly positive, but usually in a patient with lupus, CRP is negative. At presentation, most often, ESR is high, CRP is negative. And this is to do, I don't want to go in depth, but they have a type 1 interferon response. And because of the excess type 1 interferon, there is a blockade of CRP production in the liver in these patients most often. Okay. So if in a patient with SL, you see very high CRPs, you should always think about infection, coexisting infection.
Coexisting infection.
So that's one. Second thing, there are some conditions where CRP can be positive in SLE, like SLE with arthritis. When they have a lot of arthritis, they can have high CRP. And with serositis, when they have effusions, they can have high CRP. But if you have a patient of SLE who is on treatment, comes back with fever, and I am always in confusion whether this is a disease flare or is an infection. I do a CRP, and if the CRP is very high, I will always think that this is an infection.
Okay, sir.
And this is a very useful marker, especially in SLE, not in all autoimmune diseases.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So that way it will be helpful. Now you have also presented antiphospholipid antibodies. So
yes,
what are antiphospholipid antibodies? Why are you concerned? Why do you test?
So because many of the SLE patients have coexisting AMPLA antibodies as well, positive, sir, and they are at higher risk of thrombotic events. So we can put them on prophylactic aspirin or any anticoagulants that will prevent such attacks in the future, sir. That is why we do screening for AMPLA also, AMPLA antibodies also.
Should you do it in all patients with SLE?
Sir, all patients with SLE.
You're right. You should do it in all patients.
We have to do it in all patients of SLE, sir.
Ideally, we should screen them at admission, and I think good centers would also keep doing them yearly once at least. Although, again, to be practical, these are very costly tests, so we use them judiciously. But at admission or at presentation, yes, you should do them. What are those antibodies? Like, can you name them?
Sir, anti-cardiolipin antibodies, anti-beta-2 glycoprotein, and lupus anticoagulants, sir.
So these anti-cardiolipin and beta-2, usually it is both IgG, IgM. Okay, and then you have LA or lupus anticoagulant. Right. And in your patient, I think the beta 2 is positive, but you haven't told me it is IgG or IgM. So always better to see whether it is IgG positive or IgM positive. Right.
It was IgG.
Okay. Now the question is, you said that there is increased risk of thrombosis, correct?
Yes, sir.
The patient has this. How do you define APS, antiphospholipid syndrome? Is this APS? Does this patient have APS?
Sir, for antiphospholipid syndrome, one is APLA antibody is positive. Then there are four criteria, sir. One is any venous thrombotic attacks in the past, and others I don't remember, sir. I forgot.
Yeah. Anybody in the group can talk about APS? Anybody in the group? Let me check.
The presence of vascular thrombosis. The clinical criteria also includes pregnancy morbidity. And in the lab criteria, we have presence of anticardiolipin, IgG, IgM, anti-beta 2 glycoprotein, and lupus anticoagulant. So those present in medium to high titer are also necessary for fulfilling the criteria.
So yeah, you're right. So basically, the number one thing is clinical criteria. You need either thrombosis or a pregnancy morbidity. For pediatric population, essentially it is thrombosis, right? That's what you're looking at. Plus, any one of those has to be positive, but it is important that it has to be positive on two occasions. At least, I would say 12 weeks apart. That's the definition of APS, antiphospholipid syndrome. Now, why we want it to be positive on second occasion? Because many a times, even with infections, these antibodies can be positive. So unless they are persistently positive, we don't label the patient to have antiphospholipid syndrome. Correct. So what your patient actually has got is antiphospholipid antibody positivity, but not syndrome.
Syndrome. Yes.
Correct. And amongst them, which has the highest risk if these three are given, LA, beta 2, or the ACA, positivity of which has got the maximum risk? The LA.
Lupus anticoagulant.
Yeah, but if there is triple positivity, all of them are positive, then the risk is really high. Okay, and in such patients, if they are positive, we will always add aspirin, as you said, in antiplatelet doses. And we usually will recheck this after 12 weeks just to be sure whether it is positive or then negative.
Sir, okay. But how long do we continue aspirin in such patients?
If there is no thrombotic event, then as long as it is positive, we will continue it. Like you will repeat it after 3 months. If it is positive, I'll continue it and maybe repeat it after a year. And then if it is negative, I will stop it. But if there is a thrombotic event, then the situation is very different. And then invariably, they will be on anticoagulation for very long, very, very long.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, so let's go on.
So this was the criteria she fit in, sir. As per the Euler ACR criteria, she had fit in, sir, because the score was more than 10. Even as per the SLIC criteria, she was fitting, sir.
So for the benefit of the attendees, can you tell us a few criteria? One criteria that we have used for many years.
So one is SLIC criteria, sir. It came out in 2012. It has clinical criteria and immunological criteria, sir. Clinical criteria includes cutaneous manifestation, which can be acute and chronic, then ulcers, then non-scarring alopecia, then synovitis and serositis, renal manifestation, neurological manifestation, and hematological manifestation, which can be anemia, leukopenia, and thrombocytopenia. Immunological criteria will include anti-nuclear antibody positivity, double-stranded and anti-Smith, then this complement proteins and DCT positives. That okay. is to do with the SLIC criteria. And recently, the Euler ACR criteria came up in 2019. Sir. This has entry criteria as ANA positive. So if it is present, then we consider other additive criteria, sir. The problem was previous SLIC was we used to miss out many cases. So that is why this gave up, sir, Euler ACR criteria.
So if you see, conventionally, we used to use the American College of Rheumatology 1997 criteria, where you needed 4 out of 11 to somebody to be classified as lupus. Then came the SLIC criteria, and this is the recent criteria where you have given points. So basically, you are giving weightage to each manifestation. The score goes 10 or more than 10, you label as lupus. But is this a diagnostic criteria or a classification criteria?
Diagnostic.
You can go back to SLIC. No, SLIC. So what is the full form of SLIC? It is SLE, International Collaborating Clinic Criteria. These all are classification criteria. Can you see this? You have written that classification criteria.
Classification criteria.
So what is the difference between classification criteria and diagnostic criteria? Tough exam. No, so basically, if rheumatology, this is very, very important. Why I'm telling you this is, the diagnostic criteria is something you will say, yes, the patient satisfies this, I have diagnosed this patient. These criteria have been designed not for clinical purposes. They have been actually designed for study purposes, research purposes. So Dr. Ashraya may be sitting in Bangalore, I may be sitting in Mumbai and doing studies on lupus. Your patient will look very different from my patient. How do you say this is SLE? So to classify a given patient, you use these criteria. However, in clinical practice, most of our patients will satisfy this criteria. But let me tell you, if I have a patient who has got a classical butterfly rash and ANA is positive strongly, 4+, even if the patient does not satisfy criteria, I know this is lupus. And also these criteria, if you read in detail, they will say they need to be satisfied over time, not at one point.
Not at one point, yes.
So maybe today he's not satisfying, after 3 months, he may satisfy the criteria. So that is why these are not stringent criteria that if I don't satisfy the criteria, I cannot use it for treatment. And not all patients who will satisfy this criteria also need to have SLE. So that is the difference between classification criteria and a diagnostic criteria. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So let's go on.
Yes, sir. This was the final diagnosis, sir. It was a case of systemic lupus erythematosus with mucocutaneous involvement, with hematological involvement, with lupoid hepatitis. Neuropsychiatric manifestations, so that's not sure, sir, whether to consider it or not in this patient.
Yeah, I am also not pretty sure, because unless we examine the patient and do a detailed neurological examination, if there is definite slowing in response, if the reaction time is increased, then yes, I would consider neuropsychiatric lupus, because that is an important consideration in this patient. In that case, I would like to do a CSF exam. I would also do an MRI brain, because we need to rule out coexisting infections. And neuropsychiatric lupus is something which we treat very aggressively. That's why defining this would be important, both by doing clinical examination and some lab, investigations. The unfortunate part is CSF and MRI may not have any specific findings to define neuropsychiatric lupus. And many a times it is only used for exclusion, that you should not be missing something else. And that is why we do those investigations. So I think, yes, well presented. I think this is a straightforward case of SLE. And if this patient is with you, what treatment you would start?
Sir, treatment again, sir, first is to control the disease activity and then is to keep the patient on remission. So to control the disease activity, we see whether there is it is a life-threatening event or not. If it is life-threatening event, we start on pulse methylprednisolone, sir, 30 mg per day to maximum 1,000 grams per day. Then 1,000 mg per day, 1 gram per day. If not, we can give oral prednisolone at 1 to 2 mg per kg per day. Then once this is done, we can add it on with, we should keep them on tapering doses of glucocorticoids until for remission. And remission to achieve, basically, we should make it less than 7.5 gram per kg per day. Then along with this, we'll add on HCQ also, sir. Hydroxychloroquine we add on. So based on the, again, disease activity index, we can add on other drugs like azathioprine or mycophenolate mofetil, cyclophosphamide, and lastly rituximab based on the SLEDAI index.
Yeah, no, that's good. That's good. So basically the crux is based on the organ involvement and the severity, you would give steroids in most patients, either IV or oral, and almost all patients will be on hydroxychloroquine. And the steroid sparing agent would be chosen mostly based on the organ involvement. So yeah, so this is a very good learning case for you people. And SLE is something that, especially in children with prolonged fevers, you should always keep as a differential diagnosis. One more message is that if you find SLE in a very young child, say starting before the age of 5, not a common, the common age of presentation in pediatric lupus is beyond the age of 10,
yes,
usually 10 to 12. And what percentage of lupus starts in pediatrics overall? Say if you say 100 SLE, how many in pediatric?
So 20 to 30%, sir.
Yeah, 20%. So we say 10 to 20%, or you can remember 20% starts in pediatric. But it's not very common to have lupus before 5, before the age of 5. So if you have lupus before the age of 5, what would you think of? So in that situation, you think of monogenic lupus or genetic lupus. Usually lupus is not
genetic.
It is a, what do you say, multifactorial disease, what we keep talking, but it is a monogenic disease, like inherited complement C1Q deficiency can start with lupus at a very young age. So whenever you see a child with lupus starting at very young age before the age of 5, we may have to do additional genetic studies to see what caused lupus. Okay. So if there are any questions.
Yes, sir. Along with HCQ, when to add on other agents, sir?
See, in such a patient like your patient, who is, I would say, even if doesn't have neuropsychiatric involvement, has got hematological involvement, liver involvement, invariably we will start a steroid sparing agent. The only thing is, because the liver enzymes are deranged, in such a patient, I would first give steroids. Most often the liver enzymes would get better with this, and then we will start off a steroid sparing agent within a span of, say, 2 weeks. So I think most patients who have organ involvement, we will give a steroid sparing agent. And possibly in this patient, I may give azathioprine because there is liver involvement and that works well for hepatitis. But if there is neuropsychiatric involvement, I've confirmed it, then possibly I will add cyclophosphamide. Yeah.
So that to be continued for steroid sparing?
If you give cyclophosphamide, usually it is a monthly pulse that we use for six months. And then we give another agent like azathioprine for next 2 to 3 years minimum. And if you directly started azathioprine, I would say at least for 2 years we use it. How long, there is no well-defined criteria.
Based on the disease activity, we take call. And HCQ and steroids will maintain it for?
So HCQS is something that we say give very long. Maybe very long means for life, right? Yes. And steroids is something that we would try to taper and come down to a very small dose by 6 months. And in most patients with lupus, we try to stop it by 2 years.
Okay. Sir, and should we get baseline, this repeat ophthalmic, like, is there anything like every 3 months or 6 months we should get it done, ophthalmic evaluation?
See, for HCQS, they say get a baseline eye evaluation, because HCQS, the only toxicity we will be worried about is retinopathy, which is very uncommon. And at least by textbooks, we say get a yearly screen. In many adult rheumatologists say you can do an eye check after 5 years. It is that safe after you have done a baseline exam. But our practice is to do a yearly eye exam in these patients. So somebody is asking, can they have thyroid disorders? Yes, it is possible. I don't have exact numbers, but many of these patients can have coexisting hypothyroidism. So it is always a good idea to do a baseline thyroid function test in these patients.
So then there was the doubt whether there is any association between obesity and SLE, sir.
I don't see that the patients who have obesity will have increased risk of SLE, but it may be other way, like patients who have SLE and or obese, their disease control may be poor, because obesity definitely contributes to inflammation. So yes, if you have SLE with obesity, your disease control may be much poorer compared to somebody who is not obese. But obesity per se will not predispose, I would say, objectively somebody to SLE. We don't have that kind of literature.
There was a question I did not skip, sir. Is there a temporal relation between various system involvement?
No. SLE has got random involvement of organs, and no two patients with SLE are similar. So no two patients are similar. So we cannot really predict which organ can get involved. It is not that if there is liver involvement, then you will get kidney involvement. There is nothing of that sort. What we have been taught is that a patient who relapses usually relapses in the same organ. Like somebody who's got lupus nephritis, when he relapses in future, most often would relapse with lupus nephritis. But there is no particular sequence that they follow.
Sir, and lupus nephritis, they have asked upon the treatment, like highlight on.
See, lupus is one place where we do regular urine exams. And if the urinary abnormalities are there, that is an indication to do a biopsy. Basically, if you have hematuria, proteinuria, deranged nephritis, so whatever urinary abnormality you get, we have a very low threshold to do a renal biopsy, number one. The biopsy is done to define the class of lupus nephritis. So I would say you should go back and read class 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And usually 3 and 4 are the more aggressive ones. There is proliferative glomerulonephritis. Those patients are essentially treated with monthly cyclophosphamide. Or the second option these days is to give MMF. And then that is for the first 6 months. And then we maintain them on a maintenance therapy for another few years, at least for 2 years. Usually it is longer, right? For class 1 and class 2, we don't give any additional treatment. Whatever you are treating the lupus with should take care of class 1 and class 2. Class 5 is a membranous nephropathy, usually presents with nephrotic syndrome. There also the treatment is similar, steroids with cyclophosphamide. But there is some literature that you may use drugs like cyclosporine or tacrolimus because it is nephrotic syndrome. And the class 6 is an unusual thing, but the patient is coming to you with CKD. And there you will have to directly go and do a renal replacement therapy.
Sir, like when we are going through the induction phase in case of lupus nephritis, should we include steroids also, sir? Like we are giving cyclophosphamide monthly. Should we include high-dose steroids also in that induction phase? Or
see, there are different ways of giving steroids. The way we practice is that you have given the pulse at admission, and then you discharge them at 1 to 2 mg per kg. For first 4 to 6 weeks, you maintain a good dose, and then you start tapering them. So you will be on steroids. And essentially, by 6 months, you will come down possibly to 5 mg per day.
That's slowly we keep tapering it.
Yeah, we only keep tapering it along with cyclophosphamide. There are other protocols where people give monthly pulse. Monthly, okay. Every month you give one pulse. That is because you want to give very low dose oral steroid daily. So there are different ways of treating, but what I practice is to give them pulse at the beginning and then keep tapering steroids.